Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Saturday night event for the Winnipeg Radical Book Fair and DIY Fest. Tonight we're privileged to have David McNally, political economist from York University, to do our keynote speech or talk for the this year's festival. I'm going to ask David Canfield to come up and introduce our speaker for tonight. Thanks, everyone.
Glad to see so many people here. I'm very happy to introduce my friend and comrade David McNally tonight. David has been an active participant in or supporter of struggles for social change for many years, author of a number of books and articles, two books that he's written which are really directly relevant to some of the things he's going to be talking about tonight are Another World is Possible, Globalization and Anti-Capitalism, which has a second edition that came out several years ago, and I'm sure you can buy a copy of it here at Mondragon. And then most recently, Global Slump, Economics and Politics of Crisis and Resistance. David also has a blog now, having caught up with the changing trends in terms of how ideas circulate. So you can read his articles on current economic and political developments at davidmcnally.org. He's a member of Toronto New Socialists and part of the Greater Toronto Workers' Assembly, which is an effort to try to bring together different anti-capitalist activists and supporters of social struggles and labor struggles in the Toronto area, which, of course, as you know, is experiencing intense austerity coming from the municipal government of Rob Ford. There's some important anti-cuts organizing going on in the city of Toronto, which I think is unfortunately showing us the shape of things to come across the country. He's also a supporter and works closely with groups like the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty and No One is Illegal. He'll be speaking tonight on global crisis and global resistance. So please welcome David McNally.
Thank you very much, David. I'm going to just adjust this a little bit so that I'm not making everybody's ears hurt. How's that? Can people at the back hear me? Good? Okay.
You're feeding back more now.
I'm feeding back more now. Okay, let's try this. How's that? Better? Worse?
Better.
Okay, I'm going to keep it pointed down a little bit. First, I want to thank David for that introduction. Wayne, who really did all the hard work of organizing my visit to Winnipeg. Let's get that a little lower. How's that? Okay, we're going to improvise for a few minutes, folks, until we get this right. Up. Okay, are we good? Up. Okay. We happy? Okay. We'll see if we can do that without any feedback. So I do want to thank both David Canfield and Wayne Anthony for all their efforts in this regard. I also want to say that this is my second time speaking in this actual room. I've also spoken upstairs, but I was here for the fifth anniversary celebrations for Mondragon 10 years ago as one of three speakers who came out over a series of nights. So it's great to see this institution, this space for the radical left, still here 10 years later, and continue to thrive. I think I would be remiss before starting into the heart of my comments if I didn't also say that I would like to honor tonight the memory of Troy Davis, an African-American man, innocent, who was executed by the state of Georgia on Wednesday this week. And given the really powerful global campaign to save Troy Davis from execution, which was unsuccessful, I do want to honor his memory as I open my remarks. Now, the first thing I really want to emphasize tonight is that, as a philosopher once said, one of the most difficult things that all of us have in understanding is making sense of the present as history. We tend to think of history as past events that are compiled in books, and we tend to forget that what is happening in our lives right now is history in the making. And that becomes especially true in moments of great transition and transformation in world economy and world politics. And my initial contention for you tonight is that with the global financial crisis that began in 2008, we entered into an entirely new historical moment, one that is still evolving and developing, but that the world after 2008 is a dramatically different world from the quarter century prior to it. And in many respects, when I turn to talking about both global crisis and global resistance, that's my starting point. This is history in the making. Historians are later, in the coming decades, they will write the history of this great crisis and of the social resistance movements to it. But we don't know how that history ends. We don't know how that story ends because we are part of it and we will be making it. And I'll come back to that in the conclusion to my remarks. There is one mainstream book where I've seen two economists actually get this point. And because I almost always disagree with every mainstream economist out there, I'm going to quote you this one because they nailed it in this book. The book itself has no good analysis whatsoever. It's got good statistics. It's called This Time is Different. But the two authors write the following. The global financial crisis of the late 2000s stands as the most serious global financial crisis since the Great Depression. The crisis has been a transformative moment in global economic history, whose ultimate resolution will likely reshape politics and economics for at least a generation. And it is that idea that we've entered a transformative moment whose resolution will shape world economics and world politics for at least a generation. That's where I begin tonight in my comments for you. Now, we need to recognize, therefore, that contrary to what the mainstream said, and by the way, they're not saying it right now today because they're in a panic again, but contrary to what they said from about the second half of 2009 and all through 2010, this crisis did not end. It never ended. What ended was the first phase of bank collapses when central banks around the world watched in horror as private banks were melting down. And they were melting down on Wall Street, five investment banks collapsed, in Ireland, in Germany, in Spain, in Britain. Banks collapsed in one country after another. And if you read the memoirs of the politicians, the finance ministers, and so on, who were there in 2008 and 2009, they genuinely worried that the whole architecture of the global financial system was going to disintegrate, that the whole thing was going to collapse. And as a result, these characters who had told us for decades, we didn't have the money for national daycare plans, we don't have the money for Medicare in the United States, that we didn't have the money to create full employment, that the cupboard was bare, found in a matter of months $27 trillion to inject into the banks and to re-stimulate the economy. Now, to give you a sense of what $27 trillion looks like, and by the way, I don't think many of us have ever seen it, but what it looks like is this. That is the equivalent of all the wealth produced in the U.S. over 2 years being pumped into the world's banks and being used as so-called stimulus programs. In other words, when their financial system was at risk, they found money, public money, coming out of government coffers that come from the taxes of working class people. They all of a sudden found the money to bail out the banking system. But of course, that produced the next phase of the crisis, which is now in full-blown steam in Europe. Because the problem is, when you spend $27 trillion bailing out the banking system in world capitalism, governments do that by selling debt. They go around selling you an IOU saying, give me your money today, and I will repay it over the next 2, 5, 10 years with interest. But the problem is, some of the kinds of people who buy government bonds We're talking about hedge funds. We're talking about global banks. We're talking about the world's wealthiest investors and investment agencies. Those people started to take a look at just how much debt had accumulated in the public sector. And they looked at Greece, and they began to say, we don't think Greece can pay back. And they looked at Spain, and Portugal, and Ireland, and now Italy, and they're developing severe doubts that those countries can pay back their debts. But what we need to remind ourselves is that there is a completely bogus narrative that's being put out there in the mainstream, which says the Greek people lived beyond their means. That's why they're in debt. The Irish people, the people of Spain, they all live beyond their means. Nonsense. A lot of banks tried to sell toxic waste to one another. A bunch of them ended up owning it. It was called mortgage-backed securities and all kinds of other esoteric names. But banks got themselves into a crisis. They generated a system-wide crisis of capitalism. And now the mainstream is trying to blame the victims, as they always do, but it has nothing to do with working people in Greece, or pensioners in Greece, or young people in Spain, and so on. But once they realized they'd moved from a banking crisis to a government debt crisis, they then realized that since private banks own that government debt, the possibility of governments going broke, and by the way, folks, everybody out there who pays attention to it knows Greece is broke. They know Portugal's about this far from being broke, and so on. These governments, at least some of them, are going to default on their loans. And that means that some of the investors will never get back their investments. And since some of those investors are banks, guess what? We're into the next round of global bank bailout. So the $27 trillion figure I gave you, it's a moving one. It's going up and up and up. Meanwhile, as they inflict their so-called age of austerity, and keep in mind what austerity means. I'll give you a few facts and figures on parts of the world in a moment. But what austerity means is simple. Ordinary, poor, and working class people are going to pay for the bank bailout with reduced pensions, less health care, fewer teachers in schools, fewer public sector employment opportunities, in other words, fewer people working, and so on. Let me give you just a few examples of what the so-called age of austerity has looked like so far. Latvia has fired one-third of all its teachers. It's slashed pensions by 70%. Greece has slashed pensions between 30 and 50%, depending upon where your pension falls. Ireland chopped wages of government employees by 22%, and then they turned around 10 days ago and chopped the wages of nurses and others by 20% again. Russia is in the midst of eliminating one out of every five government jobs. California has eliminated health care insurance for 900,000 poor children, and the state of Michigan has ordered the city of Detroit to close half its schools. By the way, that means average class sizes in large parts of Detroit of 65 children in a class. Okay, so that's what is happening. And remember, all of this is to pay for the bank bailouts. And so when we talk about this being a transformative moment in world economics and world politics, that's what we're talking about. And while I know that in Canada we have not been hit as hard yet, we need to remember two key things. The movie that is playing in the most affected parts of the world is coming soon to a theater near us. And it's coming soon to a theater near us for two reasons. Number one, the Canadian economy, like every other, is integrated into a world economy which is sliding back into recession. As a result, it's going to feel the heat. And by the way, the Canadian economy has been shrinking the last 2 months, not growing. Secondly, once governments get into this austerity game, they start to engage in competitive austerity. Oh, If we lower corporate taxes and we drive down public sector wages, that lowers wages across society. That actually makes us attractive to investors. So now, in Manitoba and Ontario, and at the federal level, governments start to imitate the austerity program so that big business will find our backyard a more friendly, low-wage, low-regulation investment climate. So when I say it's coming soon to the theater near us, it is an inevitable part of the logic of how a global capitalist economy works. And by the way, being from Toronto, where we have a mayor in the process of inflicting $765 million in cuts to social programs, I can tell you that it's come to a theater near me really, really quickly. Let me just give you a little bit of a sense of what all of these big numbers mean in terms of some very concrete, everyday experiences. In Ireland, where the rate of unemployment was 5% when the crisis broke, the official rate is now 14.5%, and it's 27.5% for youth. In Spain, the official rate of unemployment is over 21%, and for young people, it's 45%. Big surprise that you're seeing youth occupations of city squares across Europe in response. In the United States, in the 35 largest cities in the country, the rate of unemployment for African Americans is between 30 and 35% in all 35 of those largest cities. You take the most rudimentary form of social welfare in the United States, food aid, sometimes called food stamps. There are 47 million Americans using food aid right now. And when you look at children, which is the section of the population most reliant on food aid, an amazing study came out last year which shows that in the United States, fully half of all children will require food aid at some point in their childhood. And for African American children, it is 90%. Who will require food aid. This is the richest country in the world we're talking about, where these levels of appalling poverty are part of this so-called age of austerity. And so, as a result, what we're dealing with is a crisis being inflicted on ordinary, poor, and working class people that is going on and on and on. Countries like Greece and Ireland have seen 4 and 5 austerity packages already, and world financial markets turn around and say, not enough. You got to show us more austerity if you want more loans from the International Monetary Fund and the European Central Bank. So they cut again and again and again, all of the dictates of these global financial institutions. And I did something that's kind of strange for me. I quoted to you from mainstream economists. I'm now actually going to quote a central banker and not curse in doing so, which is, again, a fairly rare thing. But this comes from Mervyn King, the governor of the Bank of England, appearing before a parliamentary committee in England in March. And Mervyn King said the following: "The price of this financial crisis is being borne by people who absolutely did not cause it." Agreed. I mean, I'm in 100% agreement with a central banker. He continues, "Now is the period when the cost is being paid. I'm surprised that the degree of public anger has not been greater than it has." That's what I want to address really in the bulk of my comments tonight. The question of public anger and mass social resistance. Because, yes, at one level, I agree with Mervyn King that it's surprising in some areas that the degree of public anger has not been higher. But I think we also need to remind ourselves that in fact we are witnessing a new global wave of mass social resistance. The problem is that as inspiring and uplifting as much of it is, most of the time it has been insufficient to the scale of this crisis. But it has been very impressive and very inspiring. So I want to share with you both some dimensions of a large picture of the resistance that we're talking about, and then talk about some of the more hopeful aspects of it from which I think those of us who want to see in the course of this transformative moment, this generation that these economists are talking about, those of us who want to see a new left emerge. I want to talk about what I think some of the most hopeful signs are. So let's remember that it is not true that poor, oppressed, and working class people around the world just stood there and submitted when the crisis broke. In December of 2008, just as the early stages of the crisis was hitting, the United States saw its first factory occupation in decades when immigrant workers at Republic Windows and Doors in Chicago took over their plant, which was getting was owned by Bank of America, or effectively owned by it, and they were losing their jobs. At the same time, workers at factories in Ireland, in France, in Britain, even five auto factories in southern Ontario, they all sat down, they all occupied their places of work in protest against layoffs and factory closures. The problem is, as important as this was, most of the time, all they were able to do was to win better severance pay. They were not able to keep the factories open. They were not able to save their jobs. The only exception to that, and here I'm going to suggest to you lies a lesson in our conversation tonight. The only exception was the factory occupations in France, which became known as boss snappings. The reason was simple. Apparently, taking over the means of production was not enough. Seizing the factory was not enough, but when you seized the boss and held him hostage, actually, that got some results. And a number of factories in France were kept, got agreements where they would be kept open until 2014, 2015, and so on, because they upped the level of insurgency. They upped the level of opposition. So it is important to recognize that. A mass upheaval in the streets of Iceland overthrew a government in the early months of this crisis, completely toppled a government which was prepared to pay back its loans to the banks across Europe. And the people said no. And by the way, the people of Iceland keep saying no in public referendums as well to paying back the banks on this. General strike swept Greece, Spain, Ireland, France, and so on. Working class people were trying to resist. They have been trying to mobilize. The problem is that big business, capital, the corporate elite, is so intent on seeing through this austerity program that they have decided that, dislike it as much as they do, they'll live with general strikes. If all you're going to do is shut the system down for a day and then go back to work, okay. They'll live with that. They don't like it, but they'll live with it. Again, I want to give you the exception. Guadeloupe and Martinique in the early months of 2009, where in these two French semi-colonies, and that's what they are, they're basically protected aspects of the French state. These two French colonies, one of them I must note for the record, the birthplace of the great Frantz Fanon, in these two islands, the trade union said two things. Number one, we are going to launch mass social resistance, not just as trade unions, but as a working class wide social movement. And so they built coalitions. In Guadeloupe, it was called Stand Up Against Exploitation. That was the name of it. It was 50 organizations. Women's groups, environmental organizations, organizations of the unemployed, student unions, as well as trade unions and so on. They all came together and they shut the place down for 30 days. When France sent in riot police, they said, fine, we'll fight the riot police in the streets. They drove them out of the streets. This was youth, unemployed people, teachers, dock workers, workers in the tourist industry and so on. The other thing they did was from the start they said, this is a movement that puts the interest of the poorest paid at the forefront. And they said, our absolutely non-negotiable demand is a 200 euro a month increase for the lowest paid in our society. Those of us who are better paid won't get as much. We'll get lower increases, but the poorest will get the biggest increase. And by the way, after a month they won, as did the workers of Guadeloupe. and it is the one example of a successful general strike against austerity measures, because A, it was built not just as an exclusively union-based operation. They built a coalition of all oppositional forces in society. B, they said, none of this one-day general strike stuff. We're out as long as it takes. And it took about a month. And C, they said, we're not fighting just for our own interests as teachers or nurses or dock workers or hotel workers. We're saying the poorest paid across the board are our priority. And that galvanized a social movement the likes of which the government of France could not defend itself against. So again, I think it's really important for us to look at those examples. Similarly, we have the examples of the youth uprisings. When you get 100,000 young people taking over the largest city squares in Madrid and Barcelona, for instance, and occupying them, and holding mass assemblies, and saying, we are the people without a future who demand a future, and so on, you are seeing the beginnings of a mass social movement. But in most of the world, we have the problem at the moment that we've got, if I can put it in these terms, a largely two-track resistance. By that, what I mean is that you've got great upheavals by young people and students, and then you've got periodic mass strikes by unions. And the places where the breakthroughs have come have been the places where those two social forces have converged, where the rebellious youth and the increasingly incensed, angry, and frustrated working class activists have come together in common fronts and common struggles. And that's where we've seen the great breakthroughs. If I were to say to you that there was one overriding lesson of the great mass upheavals earlier this year that toppled the dictatorship in Tunisia and in Egypt, it would be that. Youth-based movements got the ball rolling in both countries. But they became forces that could not be stopped only when the workers joined the movement and went into struggle. It was the general strikes declared in six cities in Tunisia after radical labor activists seized control of the General Union of Tunisian Workers that turned the tide. Because all of a sudden you had a youth rebellion and general strikes. The same thing happened. So long as they were occupying Tahrir Square in Cairo, the government didn't like it, but it thought it could ride it out. But once you had hundreds of thousands of workers on strike in the textile factories in Mahalla, on the Suez Canal, on the Cairo buses, and so on, the strike wave sweeping across the country and forming independent unions, you then had the convergence of these two mass social movements, and it became impossible. Because you're essentially bringing together, as I say, youth radicalism with insurgent labor radicalism. And that combination proves over and over again to be able to create completely new political configurations, completely new political scenarios that our rulers do not know how to manage. And as I say, for me, that's really the most inspiring of all of the examples we've seen. And if I were to sort of, you know, try to give you a bit of a feeling for what some of these mass movements look like, and I'm just giving you a sketch. In my book, Global Slump, I've tried to talk about some of these, particularly movements in Bolivia, in Oaxaca, Mexico, and in Guadeloupe and Martinique in some detail. But if I were to give you some sense, I would say what these movements have as characteristics is, first, they seize public space and create mass democratic assemblies where people who have been marginalized from political life start to feel the experience of direct democracy. When you talk to activists who are in the streets of Egypt, over and over again they explain that when the mass assemblies were going to actually broadcast their demands for the day, they would break into, notice my quotes here, small groups of 1,000 or 2. They would meet in these small groups of 1,000 or 2. They would discuss for a couple of hours. They would elect somebody. That person would then go back to a delegates' council of all the groups that were meeting. They would formulate the demands. They would then bring the demands to the loudspeaker. They would be read out across the whole of Tahrir Square. And everything that got massive cheers was an official demand of the day to be put on the government or the army or the police and so on. So when I talk about mass assembly style democracy, that's what I'm talking about. Keep in mind, they also were creating organs of popular power on the ground. They had their own police forces. They were people's police forces. In other words, there were thugs and goons from the security apparatus, from the police, and from the army trying to infiltrate the crowd. So you had to go through people's checkpoints. And if you were clearly coming in there with knives and guns and so on to attack the demonstrators, you were carefully escorted out. And by the way, in the fiercest street fighting that happened in late January in Tahrir Square, the people realized they had to create a people's prison because they were arresting soldiers and policemen on the spot, doing citizens' arrests. And so they took over a travel agency where they held 300 of these security people that they caught coming in with weapons to attack the crowd. But the point is, all of this is the experience of mass democracy in action, people starting to govern their own lives. And that has been, for me, a signal feature of all of these great experiences of rebellion over the last couple of years. So assembly-style democracy is one part of it. Street festivals, treating the upheaval, the revolution, as also having, yeah, it's fighting against the army. People died in Tahrir Square. We can never lose sight of that. But the people who were resisting also celebrated. They held their own festivals. They created a kind of culture of resistance. Again, in Tahrir Square, they set up schools. And children were taken to kindergarten-type classes and so on. They set up daycare centers because women were centrally involved in a society in which women were supposed to stay out of public and social life, and women were at the heart of all of these movements. And I'll come back to that in a moment as well. In all of these movements, anti-racism and elements of feminist liberation have been part of the story. And sometimes it is the little events which tell you so much. I couldn't appreciate this, but Egyptian activists I talked to said things like this: you knew gender relations were changing because women were smoking in public. Now, to us, that sounds like a small thing. But to have women walking around with cigarettes in the streets of Cairo was a cultural transformation impossible outside of a mass popular upheaval. Before, it wouldn't have been tolerated, the security police would have been on you, and so on, for disobeying social norms and social codes of gender relations. All of this is the everyday life level of mass social transformation. But I want to emphasize, it's not about changing lifestyles as an end in itself. It's about the transformations of everyday life that happen when millions of people mobilize together and start to change themselves in the process of changing their society in truly massive ways. In many, many of these movements, anti-racism has had to be absolutely front and center. This has been particularly true of the left indigenous movements in countries like Bolivia and Mexico, where you've got a majority of the working class population who are of indigenous descent. And so we're also seeing in a lot of these movements the articulation and recovery of indigenous forms of communalism as part of the discourse of new radical protest movements. And I'll come back to that when I talk about Chile in a moment. Before I do that, I want to share with you one passage which comes from an amazing newspaper report that appeared in the Globe and Mail. They had a correspondent in Europe as the revolution was happening in Tunisia, and they got him a few months later into Tunisia, and he went to a small town called Zarzis, and he wrote a report. And it's really quite acceptable. He couldn't believe what he was seeing. And as a result, sometimes when journalists don't know what they're seeing, they just have to describe it. And they don't give you any mundane or inane kinds of commentary. They just say, here's what I'm seeing. And this reporter, Doug Saunders with the Globe and Mail, wrote the following. He's watching Zarzis, and he says, "It is the youth who have forced out the regime-appointed mayor and set up a committee that now controls the town. They are organizing nascent institutions of local democracy. 2 days after the National Revolution, the Zarzis protesters held an election among their ranks to form a 20-person revolutionary committee. Then they held a town hall meeting with almost everyone in Zarzis attending to decide how to create a non-authoritarian municipality. Virtually all of Tunisia's old regime-appointed mayors have disappeared. So have most policemen. Garbage is collected by voluntary agreement." Each neighborhood and each community just figuring out how they're going to sort out garbage collection. "And in a great many towns, people have had a chance to reinvent the way they are managed." And I read you that passage because too often the commentary we get is focused on the big political events at the large scale. And we need to know about that. We need to know what is Mubarak's old party, the so-called NDP, doing, what is the Muslim Brotherhood doing, and so on. But we also want to know how is the fabric of daily life being transformed by a revolution that may have toppled a dictator but has not stopped. And that's the key thing to recognize, that the overthrow of the dictator was really the early innings of a revolutionary process, not the end. How it will end up, I don't know. The forces of counter-revolution are getting all kinds of American funds right now, trying to put a stop to what's going on in these events. But it's very important for those of us who stand both in solidarity with them and also are thinking about the kind of social protest movements we need to build in this next generation, I think, to be trying to understand and learn from it. I'm going to give you one more example before then just offering a couple of concluding comments. And this has to do with something I mentioned earlier, which is the mass social upheaval in Chile. And I want to talk about the example of Chile for a couple of reasons. First, Chile was the first great neoliberal experiment. It is the country that had a very convenient military dictatorship under General Pinochet, who had drowned the earlier popular unity government in blood when the military overthrew it. Pinochet invited in a bunch of hardcore right-wing economists from Chicago to help redesign the economy and the state, and they started the privatizations, the massive cuts to social programs, the crushing of trade unions, the driving down of minimum wages, the slashing of pensions, all of that they started earliest in the late 1970s in Chile. They had crushed the left in a military coup. They had established a dictatorship in which the left was incapable for some time of anything more than the smallest underground activity. Chile today is in the midst of the greatest social upheaval it has seen since the 1970s. It started with a mass student protest over tuition hikes, which then became a movement for the abolition of tuition fees, which has had repeated student strikes. By August, they moved beyond student strikes to first draw parents, grandparents, young kids, whoever, into the movement to say, it's not just about us and our tuition, it's about the future for everyone. That's why the main slogan has been, our future is not for sale. They brought 600,000 people into the streets, and once those 600,000 people came into the streets, that was the point where the mass trade union federation realized the opportunity was there to launch general strikes. And so general strike action started to take place. I'm just going to give you a little bit of a sense of what that has looked like. The students in Chile also organized through mass assemblies, assembly-style democracy of the sort that I was talking about. Their movement has continued to grow and to build, but also they have that sense of the festive that I was talking about. Yes, there are confrontations with the police. Yes, some of the student activists get arrested, but they also understand that revolutionary change is also a carnival, a festival. And so, they have held dance-a-thons in the middle of the city. They have held mass kissing marathons. They have held flash mobs of mock suicides, saying, okay, here's the future you offer for us, we'll do it for ourselves. And do the mass suicides. But what they're doing as they do all of this is they are reinventing politics. And this is really the final theme I want to close with. Part of what we're seeing is huge layers of people who have been completely alienated from traditional mainstream politics for very, very good reason. They're just not interested in traditional mainstream politics. What they're starting to understand, however, is that they are reinventing politics in the most meaningful sense of the word, which is to say, they are creating democratic mobilization in action. And that is, I think, for many of us who hope to see a new left generated in the coming period of time, that is a real inspiration. I don't want for a moment to underestimate the dangers or the challenges. This is a very tricky, complicated, potentially dangerous time in the world economy and in world politics. So please don't misunderstand me and think I'm discounting those dangers. They're real. If the austerity regime wins, there will be more human suffering on a larger scale. But at the same time, I want to share with you the conviction that that is not inevitable. But there is growing social protest, which, as I say, often hasn't been equal to the task yet. That's what we're discovering right now. General strikes aren't enough for one day. 30 days, unlimited general strikes start to look different. Factory occupations aren't enough, but boss snappings raise it a little bit. Youth occupations of city squares aren't enough, but youth occupations that converge with labor upheavals, as we're seeing now in Chile, that's a different proposition. It begins to create the elements of a new left. And that is, I think, for all of us in this room, that is going to be the key challenge, not just of next week, because we need to be thinking right now in that sense of generational change. I was in some ways fortunate, although occasionally my back is a little sore or my knees are a little creaky, you know, I'm not crazy with it. I was fortunate enough to be a high school student who came into the last New Left during the big mass demonstrations against the Vietnam War. And the strategic dilemma for us at that point was exactly the same one that is emerging again, which was to make sure we could connect the youth rebellions with working class upheaval, with working class action. In some parts of the world, some things were genuinely achieved in those regards, but by and large, the new left of the 1960s and early 1970s simply didn't have enough time, enough clarity, enough self-organization to be able to get that far. Even though some important steps were made. But I think we're already seeing in parts of the world, particularly in North Africa, to some degree in Chile now, and so on, what I'll call the outlines of a new left. And I really believe that because we're looking at years and years and years of this austerity regime and the resistance that it's generating, we have an opportunity to think about building a new left. And I suppose really the final thought I want to share with you is that I was fortunate in some ways to be a youngster in the last New Left, and I'm hoping that people like you in this room will make it possible for me to be an oldster in the next New Left. Thank you very much. Okay, let me try to do justice. These are such great questions that we really need hours of discussion. And so all I'm going to be able to do is just sort of share with you bits of outlines of some of my own thoughts on them, because clearly these are issues I struggle with, that I try to make sense of as well as somebody who's both writing about all of this and trying to operate as an activist in social movements and so on. But it seems to me that a lot of the questions come around really one overall set of issues. First, the problem of the fact that at the same time that capitalism exploits working class people, we get tied to it. We depend upon it for our employment, our livelihoods, our pensions, and so on. And that is a real contradiction that I'll try to say a few words about in a moment. As well, the term complacency was used a couple of times, and one of my views, and I talk about this in the book Global Slump, is that the successes of neoliberalism in rebuilding the power of big business, rebuilding corporate power in our society, wasn't just economic and political. It was also social and cultural. In other words, they deliberately set out to create a war on what they saw as the cultural achievements of the last new left. And they wanted to drive back popular culture on everything from gender relations to racial equality to whether education is about disciplining you and training you and making you a nice robot in the assembly line of capitalism, or whether it's about self-discovery and enlightenment. And they launched a cultural war as well. And one of the products of that is that on the one hand, the collective social movements which gave people a vision of a different kind of world were collapsing. And all kinds of people who had been out on the streets and had wanted social change and stood up in the civil rights marches and the anti-Vietnam War marches and the birth of the women's liberation movement of second wave feminism and so on, a lot of those people got discouraged and defeated, retreated, and felt that the only place they could find any happiness in their lives was on a purely individual or familial basis. Very often I believe that what we call complacency is a shrinking of the horizon of possibilities. People just don't believe that the world could be different. I mean, that's what Margaret Thatcher was trying to accomplish in her famous statement, "There is no alternative." Okay? That's what I mean by shutting down the horizons of possibility. We simply do not believe that another world is possible, which is why the World Social Forum launching that slogan 10 years ago was so important, because it was proclaiming in the face of neoliberalism, you have tried to kill the dream of a liberated future. We're reinventing it. We're reinvigorating it. We're relaunching it. But that's not to say that we don't confront all those obstacles that you're talking about. However, I want to say to you that the experience of people who are half invested in the system is also a deeply frustrating one. It may be true that somebody feels, "I sure hope my boss makes money this year so that I keep my job." But at the same time, they also feel all the daily outrages about the way working class people are treated on the job. The way they're bullied, pushed around, infantilized, the sheer unfairness of who gets promoted and gets those high salaries because of who their family background is and so on. Working class people have this complex of resentments, fears, and hopes. And what social movements do is they create the possibility that the hopes can displace a lot of the fears. That's really fundamentally what mass social movements do. And so I'm not trying to deny any of the problems. But fundamentally, people are way more complacent, if we want to use that word, i.e. non-oppositional, non-protesting, and so on, and they just don't believe anything matters, that anything will make a difference, that change is possible in their lives. I always like to remind people, because the movement against the war in Vietnam was, when I was a high school student, my first entry into politics, that of several things. First, when the first anti-war demonstration happened in the streets of New York in 1964, it had 400 people. By 1968, it had 1 million. Before the 1960s were out, the majority of Americans, now note what I'm saying here, the majority of Americans had shifted into opposition to a war being waged by their own government. We're talking about the land of the free and the home of the brave, the stars and the stripes, and all of that. And yet, in fact, a majority of people were able to come to a position that they could say, I oppose this war being waged by our government. I say that because often the positions that we see today that look entrenched are much less stable than we think. It's just that the alternatives don't seem meaningful. And so it's really important, I think, for us to understand that what minorities of people do, like the 400 who took to the streets in New York in 1964, what they do is they start to open up space for opposition within society. I mean, I have to tell you that living in a city like Toronto and watching the rise of homelessness and poverty, more and more people living on the streets and so on, it has been damn depressing. Working with groups like the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty, for instance, it's been just hard slogging dealing with the rising poverty and homelessness. And there are times when, yes, you feel despairing about the difference that you're making. And then all of a sudden, a mayor comes in who says, I'm going to get rid of the deficit, I'm not going to cut any services, and I'm not going to raise your taxes. And then turns around a few months later and says, I'm going to slash $765 million. And all of a sudden, we have an emerging mass social protest movement in the city of Toronto. Just 48 hours before I came to Winnipeg, that mayor, with his tail between his legs, publicly retreated in front of the cameras and brought none of his cuts forward today. They're coming. He's going to try it again. But the point is, they couldn't believe the outrage over closing libraries, closing homeless shelters, closing youth recreation centers, and communities of people who had not been engaged in politics. That was a really interesting thing. I work with the Stop the Cuts network in Toronto that was initiated really largely by activists with the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty and No One Is Illegal Toronto, migrant justice organizers. And what all of us have been really struck by is in one community meeting after another, the majority of people in the room have no prior history in politics. They don't come from our radical left networks. And yet you say to them, I was doing street polling for Stop the Cuts, and one of our questions is, what kind of protest do you think you'd be prepared to engage in to stop the cuts? Would you sign a petition? Would you lobby a councillor? Would you go to a demonstration? Would you engage in an occupation? Almost everybody in my polling said, oh no, I wouldn't do an occupation. That's going too far. We were polling in front of a library that's threatened with cuts, and I improvised a question that wasn't on, I ad-libbed a question that wasn't on my list, and I said, would you occupy this library if they're going to shut it down? And all kinds of people who said to me, I'd never do an occupation, said, oh yeah, sure, I'd sit in there, I'd occupy that if they were going to try to close it. And so I share with you that story because I'm trying to talk about how complicated and complex where people are at can be. People who will tell you they won't do something because it sounds like an obstruction when you say, if it's keeping subsidized daycare spaces in the city. By the way, the day before I came, there was a mass invasion of the mayor's office by mothers, fathers, and children who set up a daycare right in the mayor's vestibule. And the idea was, you know, it was an occupation with kids. And they ran a daycare center in there. And they basically said, you cut any of our daycare centers in any of our subsidized spaces, and this is where we'll be day after day running childcare. Okay? But again, most of these people were people who'd never been involved in politics. But all of a sudden the idea that subsidized daycare space is going to be slashed, because that's on the chopping block in Toronto, started to galvanize people. Now, we are light years away from the kind of social movements I've been describing in other parts of the world. So I don't want to overstate it. But nevertheless, as somebody who came through that slogging period where it was so hard to do anti-poverty organizing in the city, to all of a sudden seeing large numbers of people come up. We held a mass assembly of 600 people in a park one day, and it was like an assembly. Let's talk about how to fight this municipal government and its cuts. And again, I know the Toronto left, and it was not mainly the Toronto left. There were teachers and social workers and unemployed people and mothers at home with their kids and so on, all there in this park talking about what we need to do to stop the cuts. And so, again, there are loads of obstacles. But one of the things which can happen is because working class people who do feel fearful ties to capitalism also have a lot of resentment. That resentment can come to the fore when they're swallowing it all the time and saying things like, and you, many of you who come from working class families will know this refrain, the parents who say, I'm doing this job that I hate so my kids can have a better future. And then all of a sudden they look and it doesn't look like a better future for their kids. And it makes them bloody angry. That this is what they've done all their lives with the promise that it meant better childcare, better social services, better education, better employment prospects and so on for their children, and now it doesn't look that way. And what we're seeing in parts of Europe, what we're seeing in Chile at the moment, is a much more advanced stage of that process. But I genuinely believe that overall, we need to be thinking about how this age of austerity changes the playing field people are used to, forces them to reckon with new things, and forces them to think about doing things they didn't think they would do. And that's why I love this example of would you do an occupation? No, what about this library? Yes. Because it gets at how complicated that can be. But good social movement, grassroots organizing can build on that. I know there were a couple of other specifics that I want to make sure I don't forget. The point about co-option is, of course, absolutely correct. Once a mass social movement takes off, if they can't crush it, they'll try to co-opt parts of its leadership. No doubt about that. One of the great things about movements which are organized around grassroots democratic practices is it makes it very, very difficult for someone to go sell you out to the other side. Very, very difficult, because you're doing everything right there in the mass assembly. You're deciding on your demands together. In your breakout group, you're electing your delegate for that day, and so on. The more bureaucratic a movement is, the easier it is to co-opt it. The more it's based on grassroots democracy, the harder it is to co-opt it. So that's something we need to, you know, really just be focused on as we confront this problem. And that, I think, really, Chris, comes to the issue that you're talking about. Because as somebody, you know, who's worked on the anti-poverty front and seen the demonization of homeless people and the migrant justice front and seen the demonization of migrant workers, I hear you. That's out there. And the federal conservatives under Harper work overtime on that, right? Immigration and crime, right? Those are like absolutely central to their agenda. And I think, therefore, what's crucial about these kinds of social movements is that you create these new spaces for politics where all of a sudden people who want to save the daycare, keep the library open, make sure the youth recreation program isn't closed down and so on, find themselves interacting. There's homeless people at the mass assembly in the park. There's migrant workers who get up and speak. Also, they're not abstractions anymore. They're real people who are in this meeting with you. One of the things that really raised my spirits was that the declaration that came out from the Stop the Cuts assembly that we held in this park a couple of weeks ago. By the way, you can just Google Stop the Cuts Toronto Declaration and you'll find the declaration. it put full access to social services for all undocumented people in its demands.